Scripps. I'm the president of the Parents Association, and I thank you all so much for joining us tonight. I'm so thrilled to introduce tonight's speaker to you. I'm sure some of you have had this experience too, but it's so fun to know someone at age 12 and then see what they do in their very accomplished adult life. And I was actually able to hear Molly last spring at a luncheon that I attended with my mother, and I literally bum-rushed her after the lunch and said, "Will you come speak at Bishop's?" I'm like, "We need to hear you." So you're in for a real treat. She is a true scholar and a wonderful speaker as well. As you saw probably on her bio, a ninth generation San Diegan, which as I said last week at our PA meeting, I didn't even know was possible. She co-edits the journal San Diego History. She's a published author. She has a current book project titled American Money, The Life and Philosophy of Ellen Browning Scripps. And of course, when we conceived of this last spring, and this was not yet renovated, we were under construction, but I was like, how could we not have a preeminent Ellen Browning Scripps scholar speak in the newly renovated Ellen Browning Scripps Hall at Bishop School? Molly is a professor at the University of San Diego and also serves as the Interdisciplinary Humanities Department Chair. I had to do this just to embarrass her because Molly actually does speak quite a bit around town. She's also on the board of the La Jolla Historical Society, and she is a favorite speaker, I would say, of many organizations. So I'm used to kind of seeing her typical bio bit. So I wanted to dig a little deeper for you all tonight and a little bit more to the Bishop's end. But I did go on, and my sister's a professor at Emory, and she said, "Oh, we all don't like those sites, but they have like Rape My Professor sites." And I had to look because I knew I would not be surprised, but only delighted. Here's a couple of verbatim quotes from the Rape My Professor site on Molly. "I'm so sad that I'm graduating because I can't take another McClain class. The best prof ever." "Dr. McClain is a very nice lady and very, very smart." "Our class loves her so much, we visit her at office hours for no reason." "Take her, she is the best," in all caps. I kid you not, with three exclamation points. "She's the best. Her class is all role-playing games that trick you into learning the material." That was my favorite. I asked Molly just a couple of her recollections from Bishop's. When she recalled her favorite teacher, we actually think that we had this math teacher in common, it was Miss Anita Chafee. She later became Mrs. Maurer, wife of Otto Maurer, who was a beloved art history professor at Bishop's for many, many years. And she said, "Miss Chafee, a math teacher, because she had the most beautiful handwriting, she made math equations look like art." That wasn't exactly my memory. I don't know, math went as well for me. I was an English major. Her favorite memory from Bishop's, and when she said this and it came across my computer, I had to smile because I had instant recall. When we attended Bishop's, there were boarders here. So really, equal parts almost boarders and day students. Her favorite memory is just before Christmas break, the boarders were allowed to sing a naughty Christmas carol after formal dinners in Scripps Hall that they were all required to have, to the tune of "Hark the Herald Angels Sing." I'll just give you the first stanza because it's all I'll be allowed to say on a microphone. "Hark the herald angels shout, six more days till we get out, six more days till we are free from this penitentiary." Oh, those orders, quite a sense of humor. Anyway, without further ado, I present Dr. Molly McClain.
Much. Thanks for having me tonight. I'm very pleased to be here and to talk with you a little bit about Ellen Browning Scripps. Here she is on the cover of Time magazine from 1926. Time magazine then does, as Time magazine continues to do, it profiles kind of famous people, people who are making the news. Back in the 1920s, it was politicians and actresses, industrialists, heavyweight champions. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was on the cover, Jack Dempsey, Ethel Barrymore, Henry Ford. Scripps, on the other hand, she might have been one of the richest women in the country, but she was very far from being a celebrity, much less a household name. And in the article, the Time magazine's editors introduced her to the reader as if they had just discovered a new planet in the solar system, or a, you know, unknown element for the periodic table, right? Who is this immensely rich woman, and why does she seem determined to give away millions and millions of dollars? Ellen was born in London, and she grew up actually in poverty on the Illinois prairie. And she went from rags to riches, kind of fulfilling that cherished American story that people can pull themselves up by their bootstraps with audacity, hard work, and a little luck. Now, it helped, you know, that during the age that she was living in, that there were a number of people who did this. Andrew Carnegie, for example, started life in the United States as a textile worker and became one of the richest men in the world. Other industrialists from modest background include Cornelius Vanderbilt, John D. Rockefeller, J.P. Morgan. And these people are often described as robber barons, right? They lived in a country that prized ingenuity and industry, that encouraged the development of new technologies, and tolerated the existence of corruption, exploitation, and greed. Mark Twain humorously described this period as the Gilded Age, when glittering fortunes could be made through graft and speculation and other dubious schemes. Now, Ellen Scripps made an astonishing amount of money without either manipulating the stock market or exploiting the masses. She and her brother Edward Scripps, or E.W. Scripps, created America's largest chain of newspapers, linking Midwestern industrial cities to booming towns in the West. The Scripps papers were cheap to produce, easy to read, and pitched to a working class audience. We find that they're less well known today than, say, the papers that were produced by Joseph Pulitzer or William Randolph Hearst. Those are more familiar names for us. But the Scripps papers transformed their owners into millionaires almost overnight. By the 1920s, Ellen was worth an estimated $30 million, and if we were to translate that into modern dollars, that'd be about $4 billion, most of which she gave away. She established the Scripps Institution of Oceanography in La Jolla. She appeared on the cover actually after having founded Scripps College in Claremont. She obviously provided major financial support to the Bishop School, the La Jolla Recreational Center, Scripps Memorial Hospital, San Diego Zoo, the San Diego Society for Natural History, and founded Torrey Pines State Park. And she also donated millions of dollars worldwide to organizations that promised to advance democratic principles and women's education. So today I'd like to tell you a little bit about her life. Do you think maybe we could get the lights, maybe just in the front part of the room down, just a wee bit? Can you see this? So she was born approximately 175 years ago in 1836. And what is making a noise? Oh, that's not it. I'm going to get sucked into a hole in the ground, right? She dies in 1932 at the age of 96. Great. She lived through the Civil War, the Reconstruction, the settlement of the American West, the Gilded Age, and into the Roaring Twenties. And she died at the beginning of the Great Depression. Well, that's okay. I could use just like a little life. That's it. That's all right. So Ellen came from a family of English Methodists who believed that true democracy could only be found in America. Her great uncle settled in Rushville, Illinois in 1831 and started a newspaper. And her grandfather, who was a publisher of the London Daily Sun, another tabloid paper, also bought property there. And her father, James Mogg Scripps, had intended to stay in London, but the failure of his business and the death of his second wife forced him to make a new start in the American West. So in 1844, Ellen, aged 8, moved from London to a small town on the Illinois prairie. And this is a copy of a letter that sent to his sister with a drawing of their house in Russia. And in the letter he told her sister, he said, quote, "This place is not quite what it's cracked up to be." Her father tried to make a living at coal mining, brick making, tile laying, ice quarrying, lumber milling, farming, but no success. Ellen described him as a helpless, bookish man and something of a dreamer. Ellen had an older sister, Elizabeth, and an older brother, James, and three younger brothers, William, George, and John. Now, four more children were born after her father remarried: Fred, Thomas, Annie, Virginia, and Edward, or UW. So she's a teenage girl with lots of babies in the household. And so from a very young age, she started, you know, doing for others. She dressed, she cared for the younger children, taught them to read, helped her stepmother wash and cook. Now, while the Scripps family had very little money, they were very literate. Ellen read everything in her father's library: poetry, novels, magazines such as the Illustrated Evening News, histories, biographies. And her younger brother, E.W., would later remember, "My childhood memory of Ellen is mainly that of a neatly dressed young woman with a book in her hand." Now, Ellen first strayed from the path of conventional behavior when she attended Knox College, which was in Galesburg, Illinois, which at that time was one of the few educational institutions to admit women. And she studied science and mathematics, graduating in 1859 with a certificate from the female collegiate department. Afterwards, she returns to Rushville and teaches in the stereotypical one-room schoolhouse. When the American Civil War broke out a few years later, she moved in with her sister, helped clean, cook, wash clothes at the end of her school day. And her life as a young woman was characterized really by constant, ceaseless toil, to which she silently acquiesced. She made another unusual decision when she decided to give up her job as a school teacher and head to Detroit. At that time, it was a burgeoning industrial center in the West. And she joined her brother James E. Scripps in publishing the Detroit Evening News. And this would be the start of the Scripps family fortune. James was very tall, he had a nervous disposition, short temper, but he was determined to succeed where many other newspaper owners had failed. He kept costs down with ruthless efficiency. He was going so far as to save every scrap of paper in the office so that it could be reused again. And he employed members of the family in order to keep wages low. George Scripps, a Civil War veteran, operated the business office. William Scripps ran the printing department. E.W. Scripps, who at that time was a teenager, sold subscriptions. And Ellen worked the copy desk. And they all lived together in James's home with his growing family in a Victorian house that was not far from the railway tracks along Michigan Avenue. So between the ages of 30 and 45, Ellen worked really long 12-hour days at the Detroit Evening News, returning home each evening to care for James's young children. So what she did is she traded child care for rent and invested the bulk of her income. Now at that time there was no indoor plumbing, no electricity, and only one servant to scrub and clean. So she bathed the children at night, gave them their supper, helped with the housework and cooking, and after the evening meal, she and her brother James then would sit down, would open the cash box and count their nickels and pennies, and then they would prepare newspaper copy for the next day. And at 7 o'clock the next morning, they were back in the office again. So there was no reprieve, right? Her younger brothers could escape work, but Ellen was going to shoulder the duties both of a woman and those of a man. So it took a great deal of courage and determination for Ellen to deviate from the roles that Victorian women were supposed to play. And if she had followed the examples of her female relatives, she would have married, had children, and had a domestic life as the wife of a farmer or a small tradesman. But instead, she went to Knox College. Even after she began her career as a teacher, she could have married, if only to supplement what was a substandard wage. But Ellen went to Detroit, where she and her brothers used their newspaper to wage war on capitalist elites. And for the first time in her life, she had a purpose that absorbed her energy and utilized her considerable intelligence. She neither sought nor needed a male protector, and as a result, remained single for the rest of her life. Ellen felt herself to be, quote, an anomaly, a woman who did not fit into any known classification scheme. Her values, however, were characteristic of many women her own age. Like most Victorians, she glorified home and family, even if she doesn't have one of her own. She was devoted to her relatives, brothers, sisters, nieces, nephews, in-laws, cousins, and she felt that it was her duty to care for and protect those in need. She admired moral courage, self-sacrifice, and cooperation, and hero-worshipped men like President Abraham Lincoln. She was an abolitionist committed to ending the practice of slavery and to helping the homeless and downtrodden. Still, when she tried to practice the female virtues so admired in the Victorian period, patience, piety, submission, her intelligence and good sense, not to mention good sense of humor, usually got in the way. She was bitter with frugality and industry, at least in the early years. It was her good fortune to invest in newspapers at a time when 19th century Americans had become mesmerized by the printed word. Newspaper subscriptions increased exponentially during the Civil War as people hungered after news of troop movements and battles, casualties. Once the habit had formed, it was hard to break. Subscriptions kept rising in the 1870s and the 1880s when publishers introduced the 1 cent or penny papers to booming Western cities such as Chicago, Detroit, and St. Louis. And in the 1890s, one journalist remarked, quote, "It was during the war that the American people contracted the newspaper habit from which they have never recovered. Cheap prices encouraged working class readers to indulge their taste for sensational gossip, true crime, sports, adventure, fashion, and new advertisers quickly jumped on board. By 1900, the news had become a commodity to be shaped, packaged, and marketed with an eye for profit. James Scripps had been there in the beginning, and Ellen had thrown in her lot with him. She took her salaries and shares, made loans to cover cash flow gaps, and never withdrew her principal. A working woman, she understood the value of property and the insecurity of wealth in the modern age." As Ellen approached 50 years of age, she found herself slowly edged out of the family business. James no longer needed her help at the copy desk, and EW couldn't find a place for her on the Cincinnati Post. She felt she needed to do something, but she wasn't sure quite what. Her younger brother suggested that she pursue the same kinds of activities as other unmarried women. She replied, quote, "I am puzzled over your supposititious old maid line of conduct that I am likely to pursue. To my own humiliation, I must plead utter ignorance of what such a line of conduct should be. I am a very old maid in years, but in everything else, I'm an anomaly. I don't know anything about what an old maid ought or is expected to be or to do." In 1890, a trip to California gave her a renewed sense of purpose. She and her brother Fred went to Alameda to visit their sister. And there's Fred in the center and Annie on the right. And Annie suffered from crippling rheumatoid arthritis. And Ellen had tremendous doubts about the utopian community that her sister had joined. It was called the New Order of Life. But she left her sister to her paradise in Alameda and headed south to San Diego to visit a cousin who was working on the San Diego Sun, a newspaper. Now at that time, San Diego was still reeling from the effects of economic depression caused by railway overbuilding, bank failures, and the collapse of the real estate market. Not unlike our own time. But it had a warm and dry climate that appealed to Fred, who had endured a serious illness, probably either malaria or rheumatic fever. And Ellen Helen also was affected by the mild winter. She, in March, she wrote in her diary that people were bathing in the sea. Wow. So in 1891, Ellen and her brother E.W. purchased 400 acres of land in San Diego and began building a ranch on a wide flat-top ridge overlooking the Linda Vista Mesa, and they named it Miramar, which in Spanish means sea view. The land was cheap, but it had little to recommend it, and the Pacific Ocean was 15 long, dusty miles away. From Miramar, E.W. directed the beginnings of what would become a great newspaper empire, while Ellen began to wonder if she would ever be free of her family. Far from being the ideal Victorians, the Scripps family was divided into warring camps that clashed over power, personality, and property. In her darkest hours, Ellen imagined living on a desert island, quote, where no one shall make me afraid, and where the air that I breathe will not be tainted, nor my ears polluted, with the foul smell and sound of money. At the turn of the 20th century, San Diego was not quite a desert island, even if it resembled one. While a small population of Anglos had settled along the border in the wake of the U.S.-Mexican War, California was still a newly acquired territory rather than a well-populated American state. The real estate market had crashed just before Ellen arrived, leaving behind cheap land, abandoned homesteads, and empty hotels. It took a lot of imagination and foresight to suppose that San Diego would one day become a cultured urban center, you know, much less our earthly paradise of sun, sea, and sand, which we all enjoy. So when she was 60 years old, Ellen made a new life for herself in La Jolla, which at that time was a rustic arts colony overlooking the sea. In 1896, she bought two lots on Prospect Street and began building a house. When it was finished, it looked considerably grander than many of the seaside cottages that surrounded it. But compared to the quote-unquote cottages that at the same time were being built in Bar Harbor or Newport, Rhode Island, right, this was very modest indeed. And she herself just described how much she loved its, quote, simplicity and unpretentiousness. And she named herself Moulton Villa after the street in London where she had been born. For all her wealth, Ellen never acted the part of a wealthy woman. She kept few servants, lived frugally, wore out her old clothes. She ate sparingly, slept under the stars on a roofless porch, and took public transportation around San Diego until she was 80 years old. She spent money only on items that would benefit the greater community. She opened her extensive gardens to the public and made her car available for use by neighbors and friends. In the words of one journalist, she regarded wealth as, quote, a trust for the benefit of humanity rather than a source of status for her family or herself. Between 1905 and 1915, Ellen began a decade of building in La Jolla, financing the construction of public spaces such as a library, a playground, and a school. She was not trying to just improve the appearance of the village or to increase property values, but to create the kind of institutions that would encourage democratic principles, promote social progress, and to contribute to what she described as, quote, the evolution and uplift of the human race. Her first significant project was the Bishop's School for Girls, commissioned in 1909 by the Right Reverend Joseph Horsfall Johnson, Bishop of Los Angeles. Ellen saw women's education as part of a greater movement towards freedom and democracy. One of her friends wrote, she thought that women ought to be the equal of men. They would have their work, interest, and place just as much as men should. And this was really her idea, end quote. The Bishop's School was founded at a time of expanding educational opportunities for women. Between 1870 and 1900, the number of women enrolled in colleges and universities multiplied eightfold, from 11,000 to 85,000. Women's colleges such as Vassar, Wellesley, Smith, and Bryn Mawr became national institutions. Women attended co-educational schools such as Boston College and Oberlin, and they also enrolled in large state universities. Although elite men's colleges such as Harvard and Columbia did not admit women, reformers continued to press for access, and their efforts resulted in the creation of Barnard, Rec, and Radcliffe as affiliated women's colleges. It's interesting to note, though, in the early years, relatively few women took up the challenge of higher education. Some public high schools prepared their students to attend state normal schools, essentially to become teachers. Most, however, didn't offer the kind of curriculum that would help students pass the rigorous college entrance exams that were required by elite institutions. So independent girls' schools were a novelty around the turn of the century. The Bryn Mawr School, for example, which is one of the earliest of the girls' preparatory schools, founded in 1885, offered one of the first college prep programs for women. Other ones included the Brearley School in New York, the Marlborough School in LA, and the National Cathedral School in Washington. So in 1907, Bishop Johnson began laying plans for a girls' preparatory school in Southern California, and he tapped Anna Bentham and her husband, Reverend Charles Bentham, to head the new school. Initially, he thought he'd build it in Sierra Madre, not far from Pasadena. But he altered his plans when two prominent San Diegans offered to become benefactors, and that was Ellen Browning Scripps and her sister, Eliza Virginia Scripps. So two schools would be built, a day school in San Diego and a boarding school in La Jolla. So in 1908, both Ellen and Virginia were flush with money. After a lengthy court battle, Ellen had just inherited a sizable amount of newspaper stock from her brother George, and Virginia received a lesser sum. Her brother had never given away any money to charitable organizations, so she decided to do it for him, starting with the Scripps Institution of Oceanography. So this, her first plunge of philanthropy, she used it to kind of cleanse herself and the Scripps family name of what had become a very scandalous lawsuit that had tarnished the Scripps name for over a decade. So in her words, instead of settling old scores, she decided to substitute useful, worthy projects that would benefit society and not help members of her own family get rich. Ellen recommended that the architect Irving Gill be chosen to design the Bishop School. She had commissioned him to build St. James Chapel above there, and this is where the St. James by the Sea is currently now, and that sweet little chapel has been moved to Genter Street. I don't know if you ever noticed it on that street? Yeah. He built this, and he also built the Scripps Biological Station below. So the top, obviously, is a Mission Revival building, and the ladder below is a flat-roofed, concrete, assertively planned structure that reflected the design philosophy of international modernists like Adolf Loos. Gill's first structure for the La Jolla campus, Scripps Hall, was a white concrete building with long arcades, and an article in Craftsman magazine praised it as fireproof, sanitary, and so free from superfluous ornament that it furnishes a new standard for architectural simplicity. The white walls captured the color of the sunset and glowed like opals. Inside, the plain rooms allowed each girl to express her individuality by choosing the decorations. Doors were made of a single panel of wood, and there were no moldings, cornices, or baseboards to collect and hold dirt. The artist concerned with health and sanitation reflected the contemporary belief that disease and poor health were caused by dampness, dust, germs, and air pollution. So his realization that buildings could solve social problems put him at the forefront of the modernist movement in architecture. I have another picture of Scripps Hall here with the Bentham Tower, and the old Bentham Tower in the background. You can see the railway tracks were going along Prospect Street, just past the school. Now, Scripps became personally interested in the Bishop School, contributing more money than she had planned. She explained to her attorney, quote, "The execution of the building itself has not exceeded the cost or risk originally contemplated, but you know how things grow. One thing leads to another and necessitates another, and the improvement of the grounds, the artistic bills of finishing, the furnishing, etc., etc., etc. Her lawyer was always trying to get on her about how much money she spent. But she believed that the school was, quote, destined to be a great institution and therefore worth the investment. She wrote, "I feel more than assured that I have embarked in an undertaking that is almost limitless in its scope and power for good." Her sister Virginia also felt responsible for the future of the institution. She donated about $20,000 and several parcels of land in 1909. She later turned over most of her La Jolla properties to the school in return for a scholarship endowment. She worked on the grounds, planting lawns, vines, flowering shrubs. She also maintained the tennis, croquet, and basketball courts around the school. Her eccentricities, which included rearranging the drawing room furniture, endeared her to the students, who in 1914 selected her as senior class mascot. Bishop's headmistress kept academics foremost in the minds of students. After going to chapel early in the morning, the girls spent the next 5 hours in the classroom. They attended two mandatory study halls from 4:30 to 6 in the afternoon and from 8 to 9 in the evening. Seniors took advanced classes in both geometry and arithmetic. They also developed a portfolio of their work to display at commencement. And by 1916, Bishop's students were sufficiently well prepared to pass the often rigorous college entrance exams. In 1917, the headmistress told a meeting of the Board of Trustees what the graduating class would be doing. And she said, "There's one at Vassar, one at Barnard, one at Occidental, two at Berkeley, one at Mills, one at Syracuse, one in business, one in society, and one a question mark." The school also emphasized sports, particularly tennis and basketball. Students divided into two teams, which were called Harvard and Yale, and competed with one another. In 1917, the teams changed their name to Army and Navy to recognize the U.S. participation in the war. Educational reformers paid particular attention to physical activity as a way to prevent the kind of ill health that had plagued 19th century women. Other solutions included fresh air, balanced meals, adequate ventilation, and calisthenics. At Bishop's, the boarders took cold baths, which was intended to stimulate intellectual activity. And on warm nights, they actually slept on the porch outside of Gilman Hall and on the arcade above Scripps Hall. They did calisthenics and competed in swimming contests at Del Mar. They also applied their education to real-world problems. During World War I, they planted potatoes in the quad, which is what she's doing here, and they learned how to make surgical bandages. So the girls in the upper window there are actually in a surgical bandage-making class, so they've got their hair, you know, covered. Like the Red Cross workers would. One girl, Helen Marston Beardsley, would return home from Wellesley College each summer to work at Neighborhood House, where she helped impoverished Mexican families. And she later founded a branch of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. Other graduates also wholeheartedly embraced progressive reform. Scripps approved of such work, writing in 1920, quote, "It is so good to find women doing things instead of spending their time in cooking dainties and embroidering underwear." Bishop Johnson spent a great deal of time in La Jolla in the early 1920s. He was very proud of his La Jolla school and enjoyed showing it off to educators visiting from the East Coast. It compared very favorably to the Harvard School, which was a boy, now it's the Harvard Westlake School, a boys' preparatory school that he also founded in Los Angeles. Scripps offered the bishop the use of her bungalow and limousine when he came to La Jolla, and they would have long breakfasts over pancakes and maple syrup, because the bishop rose early and made breakfast his principal meal. breakfast actually with Ellen led to the creation of Scripps College. The bishop actually had once planned to create a college here in La Jolla, but his experience as a trustee of Pomona College showed him how difficult such an undertaking would be. So instead, he and Dr. James Blaisdell, who is the president of Pomona College, encouraged Scripps to provide the foundation for a women's college in Claremont, where the existence of another institution would create economies of scale. And so this was the start of the Claremont College Consortium that was modeled on Oxford and Cambridge. Scripps continued to support the Bishop School until her death on August 4th, 1932. She provided a large endowment, and in 1924 gave money for a new gymnasium with an auditorium and swimming pool. She also left a substantial bequest. At the end of her life, she told a friend, quote, "One of the greatest delights of her life had been teaching," and she believed that schools should be, quote, an open door to knowledge, and that educational methods should reflect the experimental age in which they lived. The Bishop Schools continues the philanthropic legacy started by Ellen Browning Scripps. It was her belief, quote, "It is the thing that is done that counts, not the person who does it, who is only the instrument of a perpetual universal energy." So we all contribute to that universal energy when we give our time, money, and labor to a greater cause. And I think in this room, the Bishop School is the cause or focus for many of us. So I hope we can all help bishops fulfill its promise to educate, empower, and empower both the men and the women of San Diego. Thank you. She's born about 175 years ago in 1836, and she dies in 1932 at the age of 96. Great. She lived through the Civil War, the Reconstruction, the settlement of the American West, the Gilded Age, and into the Roaring Twenties. And she died at the beginning of the Great Depression. Well, that's okay. I could use just like a little light. That's it. That's So Ellen came from a family of English Methodists who believed that true democracy could only be found in America. Her great uncle settled in Rushville, Illinois in 1831 and started a newspaper. And her grandfather, who was a publisher of the London Daily Sun, another tabloid paper, also bought property there. And her father, James Mogg Scripps, had intended to stay in London, but the failure of his business and the death of his second wife forced him to make a new start in the American West. So in 1844, Ellen, aged 8, moved from London to a small town on the Illinois prairie. And this is a copy of a letter that her father sent to his sister with a drawing of their house in Rushville. And in the letter, he told her sister, he said, quote, "This place is not quite what it's cracked up to be." Her father tried to make a living at coal mining, brick making, tile laying, ice quarrying, lumber milling, farming, but no success. Ellen described him as a helpless, bookish man and something of a dreamer. Ellen had an older sister, Elizabeth, and an older brother, James, and three younger brothers, William, George, and John. Now, four more children were born after her father remarried: Fred, Thomas, Annie, Virginia, and Edward, or E.W. So she's a teenage girl with lots of babies in the household. And so from a very young age, she started, you know, doing for others. She dressed, she cared for the younger children, taught them to read, helped her stepmother wash and cook. Now, while the Scripps family had very little money, they were very literate. Ellen read everything in her father's library: poetry, novels, magazines such as the Illustrated Evening News, histories, biographies. And her younger brother, E.W., would later remember, "My childhood memory of Ellen is mainly that of a neatly dressed young woman with a book in her hand." Now, Ellen first strayed from the path of conventional behavior when she attended Knox College, which was in Galesburg, Illinois, which at that time was one of the few educational institutions to admit women. And she studied science and mathematics, graduating in 1859 with a certificate from the female collegiate department. Afterwards, she returns to Rushville and teaches in the stereotypical one-room schoolhouse. When the American Civil War broke out a few years later, she moved in with her sister, helped clean, cook, wash clothes at the end of her school day. And her life as a young woman was characterized really by constant, ceaseless toil, to which she silently acquiesced. She made another unusual decision when she decided to give up her job as a school teacher and head to Detroit. At that time, it was a burgeoning industrial center in the West. And she joined her brother James E. Scripps in publishing the Detroit Evening News. And this would be the start of the Scripps family fortune. James was very tall, he had a nervous disposition, short temper, but he was determined to succeed where many other newspaper owners had failed. He kept costs down with ruthless efficiency. He was going so far as to save every scrap of paper in the office so that it could be reused again. And he employed members of the family in order to keep wages low. George Scripps, a Civil War veteran, operated the business office. William Scripps ran the printing department. E.W. Scripps, who at that time was a teenager, sold subscriptions. And Ellen worked the copy desk. And they all lived together in James's home with his growing family in a Victorian house that was not far from the railway tracks along Michigan Avenue. So between the ages of 30 and 45, Ellen worked really long 12-hour days at the Detroit Evening News, returning home each evening to care for James's young children. So what she did is she traded child care for rent and invested the bulk of her income. Now at that time there was no indoor plumbing, no electricity, and only one servant to scrub and clean. So she bathed the children at night, gave them their supper, helped with the housework and cooking, and after the evening meal, she and her brother James then would sit down, would open the cash box and count their nickels and pennies, and then they would prepare newspaper copy for the next day. And at 7 o'clock the next morning, they were back in the office again. So there was no reprieve, right? Her younger brothers could escape work, but Ellen was going to shoulder the duties both of a woman and those of a man. So it took a great deal of courage and determination for Ellen to deviate from the roles that Victorian women were supposed to play. And if she had followed the examples of her female relatives, she would have married, had children, and had a domestic life as the wife of a farmer or a small tradesman. But instead, she went to Knox College. Even after she began her career as a teacher, she could have married, if only to supplement what was a substandard wage. But Ellen went to Detroit, where she and her brothers used their newspaper to wage war on capitalist elites. And for the first time in her life, she had a purpose that absorbed her energy and utilized her considerable intelligence. She neither sought nor needed a male protector, and as a result, remained single for the rest of her life. Ellen felt herself to be, quote, an anomaly, a woman who did not fit into any known classification scheme. Her values, however, were characteristic of many women her own age. Like most Victorians, she glorified home and family, even if she doesn't have one of her own. She was devoted to her relatives, brothers, sisters, nieces, nephews, in-laws, cousins, and she felt that it was her duty to care for and protect those in need. She admired moral courage, self-sacrifice, and cooperation, and hero worshiped men like President Abraham Lincoln. She was an abolitionist committed to ending the practice of slavery and to helping the homeless and downtrodden. Still, when when she tried to practice the female virtues so admired in the Victorian period, patience, piety, submission. Her intelligence and good sense, not to mention good sense of humor, usually got in the way. She was bitter with frugality and industry, at least in the early years. It was her good fortune to invest in newspapers at a time when 19th century Americans had become mesmerized by the printed word. Newspaper subscriptions increased exponentially during the Civil War as people hungered after news of troop movements and battles, casualties. Once the habit had formed, it was hard to break. Subscriptions kept rising in the 1870s and the 1880s when publishers introduced the 1 cent or penny papers to booming Western cities such as Chicago, Detroit, and St. Louis. And in the 1890s, one journalist remarked, quote, "It was during the war that the American people contracted the newspaper habit from which they have never recovered." Cheap prices encouraged working class readers to indulge their taste for sensational gossip, true crime, sports, adventure, fashion, and new advertisers quickly jumped on board. By 1900, the news had become a commodity to be shaped, packaged, and marketed with an eye for profit. James Scripps had been there in the beginning, and Ellen had thrown in her lot with him. She took her salaries and shares, made loans to cover cash flow gaps, and never withdrew her principal. A working woman, she understood the value of property and the insecurity of wealth in the modern age. As Ellen approached 50 years of age, she found herself slowly edged out of the family business. James no longer needed her help at the copy desk, and EW couldn't find a place for her on the Cincinnati Post. She felt she needed to do something, but she wasn't sure quite what. Her younger brother suggested that she pursue the same kinds of activities as other unmarried women. She replied, quote, "I am puzzled over your supposititious old maid line of conduct that I am likely to pursue. To my own humiliation, I must plead utter ignorance of what such a line of conduct should be. I am a very old maid in years, but in everything else, I'm an anomaly. I don't know anything about what an old maid ought or is expected to be or to do." In 1890, a trip to California gave her a renewed sense of purpose. She and her brother Fred went to Alameda to visit their sister. And there's Fred in the center and Annie on the right. And Annie suffered from crippling rheumatoid arthritis. And Ellen had tremendous doubts about the utopian community that her sister had joined. It was called the New Order of Life. But she left her sister to her paradise in Alameda and headed south to San Diego to visit a cousin who was working on the San Diego Sun, a newspaper. Now at that time, San Diego was still reeling from the effects of economic depression caused by railway overbuilding, bank failures, and the collapse of the real estate market. Not unlike our own time. But it had a warm and dry climate that appealed to Fred, who had endured a serious illness, probably even malaria, rheumatic fever. And Ellen also was affected by the mild winter. In March, she wrote in her diary that people were bathing in the sea. Wow. So in 1891, Ellen and her brother E.W. purchased 400 acres of land in San Diego and began building a ranch on a wide flat-top ridge overlooking the Linda Vista Mesa. And they named it Miramar, which in Spanish means sea view. The land was cheap, but it had little to recommend it, and the Pacific Ocean was 15 long, dusty miles away. From Miramar, EW directed the beginnings of what would become a great newspaper empire, while Ellen began to wonder if she would ever be free of her family. Far from being the ideal Victorians, the Scripps family was divided into warring camps that clashed over power, personality, and property. In her darkest hours, Ellen imagined living on a desert island, quote, "where no one shall make me afraid, and where the air that I breathe will not be tainted, nor my ears polluted with the foul smell and sound of money." turn of the 20th century, San Diego was not quite a desert island, even if it resembled one. While a small population of Anglos had settled along the border in the wake of the U.S.-Mexican War, California was still a newly acquired territory rather than a well-populated American state. The real estate market had crashed just before Ellen arrived, leaving behind cheap land, abandoned homesteads, and empty hotels. It took a lot of imagination and foresight to suppose that San Diego would one day become a cultured urban center, you know, much less our earthly paradise of sun, sea, and sand, which we all enjoy. So when she was 60 years old, Ellen made a new life for herself in La Jolla, which at that time was a rustic arts colony overlooking the sea. In 1896, she bought two lots on Prospect Street and began building a house. When it was finished, it looked considerably grander than many of the seaside cottages that surrounded it. But compared to the quote-unquote cottages that at the same time were being built in Bar Harbor or Newport, Rhode Island, right, this was very modest indeed. And she herself just described how much she loved its, quote, simplicity and unpretentiousness. And she named herself Moulton Villa after the street in London where she had been born. For all her wealth, Ellen never acted the part of a wealthy woman. She kept few servants, lived frugally, wore out her old clothes. She ate sparingly, slept under the stars on a roofless porch, and took public transportation around San Diego until she was 80 years old. She spent money only on items that would benefit the greater community. She opened her extensive gardens to the public and made her car available for use by neighbors and friends. In the words of one journalist, she regarded wealth as, quote, a trust for the benefit of humanity rather than a source of status for her family or herself. Between 1905 and 1915, Ellen began a decade of building in La Jolla, financing the construction of public spaces such as a library, a playground, and a school. She was not trying to just improve the appearance of the village or to increase property values, but to create the kind of institutions that would encourage democratic principles, promote social progress, and to contribute to what she described as, quote, the evolution and uplift of the human race. Her first significant project was the Bishop School for Girls, commissioned in 1909 by the Right Reverend Joseph Horsfall Johnson, Bishop of Los Angeles. Ellen saw women's education as part of a greater movement towards freedom and democracy. One of her friends wrote, she thought that women ought to be the equal of men. They would have their work, interest, and place just as much as men should. And this was really her idea, end quote. The Bishop School was founded at a time of expanding educational opportunities for women. Between 1870 and 1900, the number of women enrolled in colleges and universities multiplied eightfold, from 11,000 to 85,000. Women's colleges such as Vassar, Wellesley, Smith, and Bryn Mawr became national institutions. Women attended co-educational schools such as Boston College and Oberlin, and they also enrolled in large state universities. Although elite men's colleges such as Harvard and Columbia did not admit women, reformers continued to press for access, and their efforts resulted in the creation of Barnard, and Radcliffe as affiliated women's colleges. It's interesting to note, though, in the early years, relatively few women took up the challenge of higher education. Some public high schools prepared their students to attend state normal schools, essentially to become teachers. Most, however, didn't offer the kind of curriculum that would help students pass the rigorous college entrance exams that were required by elite institutions. So independent girls' schools were a novelty around the turn of the century. The Bryn Mawr School, for example, which is one of the earliest of the girls' preparatory schools, founded in 1885, offered one of the first college prep programs for women. Other ones included the Brearley School in New York, the Marlborough School in LA, and the National Cathedral School in Washington. So in 1907, Bishop Johnson began laying plans for a girls' preparatory school in Southern California, and he tapped Anna Bentham and her husband, Reverend Charles Bentham, to head the new school. Initially, he thought he'd build it in Sierra Madre, not far from Pasadena. But he altered his plans when two prominent San Diegans offered to become benefactors, and that was Ellen Browning Scripps and her sister, Eliza Virginia Scripps. So two schools would be built, a day school in La Jolla, a day school in San Diego, and a boarding school in La Jolla. So in 1908, both Ellen and Virginia were flush with money. After a lengthy court battle, Ellen had just inherited a sizable amount of newspaper stock from her brother George, and Virginia received a lesser sum. Her brother had never given away any money to charitable organizations, so she decided to do it for him, starting with the Scripps Institution of Oceanography. So this, her first plunge in philanthropy, she used it to kind of cleanse herself and the Scripps family name of what had become a very scandalous lawsuit that had tarnished the Scripps name for over a decade. So in her words, instead of settling old scores, she decided to substitute useful, worthy projects that would benefit society and not help members of her own family get rich. Ellen recommended that the architect Irving Gill be chosen to design the Bishop School. She had commissioned him to build St. James Chapel above there, and this is where the St. James by the Sea is currently now, and that sweet little chapel has been moved to Ginter Street. I don't know if you ever noticed it on that street? Yeah. He built this, and he also built the Scripps Biological Station below. So the top, obviously, is a Mission Revival building, and the ladder below is a flat-roofed, concrete, assertively planned structure that reflected the design philosophy of international modernists like Adolf Loos. Gill's first structure for the La Jolla campus, Scripps Hall, was a white concrete building with long arcades, and an article in Craftsman magazine praised it as fireproof, sanitary, and so free from superfluous ornament that it furnishes a new standard for architectural simplicity. The white walls captured the color of the sunset and glowed like opals. Inside, the plain rooms allowed each girl to express her individuality by choosing the decorations. Doors were made of a single panel of wood, and there were no moldings, cornices, or baseboards to collect and hold dirt. The artist concerned with health and sanitation reflected the contemporary belief that disease and poor health were caused by dampness, dust, germs, and air pollution. So his realization that buildings could solve social problems put him at the forefront of the modernist movement in architecture. I have another picture of Scripps Hall here with the Bentham Tower, and the old Bentham Tower in the background. And you can see the railway tracks were going along Prospect Street, just past the school. Now, Scripps became personally interested in the Bishop School, contributing more money than she had planned. She explained to her attorney, quote, "The execution of the building itself has not exceeded the cost originally contemplated, but you know how things grow. One thing leads to another and necessitates another in the improvement of the grounds, the artistic bills of finishing, the furnishing, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera." Her lawyer was always getting on her about how much money she spent. But she believed that the school was, quote, "destined to be a great institution and therefore worth the investment." She wrote, "I feel more than assured that I have embarked in an undertaking that is almost limitless in its scope and power for good." Her sister Virginia also felt responsible for the future of the institution. She donated about $20,000 and several parcels of land in 1909. She later turned over most of her La Jolla properties to the school in return for a scholarship endowment. She worked on the grounds, planting lawns, vines, flowering shrubs. She also maintained the tennis, croquet, and basketball courts around the school. Her eccentricities, which included rearranging the drawing room furniture, endeared her to the students, who in 1914 selected her as senior class mascot. Bishop's headmistress kept academics foremost in the minds of students. After going to chapel early in the morning, the girls spent the next 5 hours in the classroom. They attended two mandatory study halls from 4:30 to 6 in the afternoon and from 8 to 9 in the evening. Seniors took advanced classes in both geometry and arithmetic. They also developed a portfolio of their work to display at commencement. And by 1916, Bishop's students were sufficiently well prepared to pass the often rigorous college entrance exams. In 1917, the headmistress told a meeting of the Board of Trustees what the graduating class would be doing. And she said, there's one at Vassar, one at Barnard, one at Occidental, two at Berkeley, one at Mills, one at Syracuse, one in business, one in society, and one a question mark. The school also emphasized sports, particularly tennis and basketball. Students divided into two teams, which are called Harvard and Yale, and competed with one another. In 1917, the teams changed their name to Army and Navy to recognize the U.S. participation in the war. Educational reformers paid particular attention to physical activity as a way to prevent the kind of ill health that had plagued 19th century women. Other solutions included fresh air, balanced meals, adequate ventilation, and calisthenics. At Bishop's, the boarders took cold baths, which was intended to stimulate intellectual activity. And on warm nights, they actually slept on the porch outside of Gilman Hall and on the arcade above Scripps Hall. They did calisthenics and competed in swimming contests at Dunbar. They also applied their education to real-world problems. During World War I, they planted potatoes in the quad, which is what she's doing here. And they learned how to make surgical bandages. So the girls in the upper window there are actually in a surgical bandage-making class. So they've got their hair, you know, covered like the Red Cross workers would. One girl, Helen Marston Beardsley, would return home from Wellesley College each summer to work at Neighborhood House, where she helped impoverished Mexican families. And she later founded a branch of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. Other graduates also wholeheartedly embraced progressive reform. Scripps approved of such work, writing in 1920, quote, "It is so good to find women doing things instead of spending their time in cooking dainties and embroidering underwear." Bishop Johnson spent a great deal of time in La Jolla in the early 1920s. He was very proud of his La Jolla school and enjoyed showing it off to educators visiting from the East Coast. It compared very favorably to the Harvard School, which was a boy, now it's the Harvard Westlake School, a boys' preparatory school that he also founded in Los Angeles. Scripps offered the bishop the use of her bungalow and limousine when he came to La Jolla, and they would have long breakfasts over pancakes and maple syrup, because the bishop rose early and made breakfast his principal meal. So these early morning breakfasts actually with Ellen led to the creation of Scripps College. The bishop actually had once planned to create a college here in La Jolla, but his experience as a trustee of Pomona College showed him how difficult such an undertaking would be. So instead, he and Dr. James Blaisdell, who is the president of Pomona College, encouraged Scripps to provide the foundation for a women's college in Claremont, where the existence of another institution would create economies of scale. And so this was the start of the Claremont College Consortium that was modeled on Oxford and Cambridge. Scripps continued to support the Bishop School until her death on August 4th, 1932. She provided a large endowment, and in 1924 gave money for a new gymnasium with an auditorium and swimming pool. She also left a substantial bequest. At the end of her life, she told a friend, quote, "One of the greatest delights of her life had been teaching, and she believed that schools should be, quote, an open door to knowledge, a and that educational methods should reflect the experimental age in which they lived. The Bishop Schools continues the philanthropic legacy started by Ellen Browning Scripps. It was her belief, quote, "It is the thing that is done that counts, not the person who does it, who is only the instrument of a perpetual universal energy." So we all contribute to that universal energy when we give our time, money, and labor to a greater cause. And I think in this room, the Bishop School is the cause or focus for many of us. So I hope we can all help bishops fulfill its promise to educate, empower, and empower both the men and the women of San Diego. Thank you.
Joining us tonight. I'm so thrilled to introduce tonight's speaker to you. I'm sure some of you have had this experience too, but it's so fun to know someone at age 12 and then see what they do in their very accomplished adult life. And I was actually able to hear Molly last spring at a luncheon that I attended with my mother, and I literally bum rushed her after the lunch and said, "Will you come speak at Bishop's?" I'm like, "We need to hear you." So you're in for a real treat. She is a true scholar and a wonderful speaker as well. As you saw probably on her bio, a ninth generation San Diegan, which as I said last week at our PA meeting, I didn't even know was possible. She co-edits the journal San Diego History. She's a published author. She has a current book project titled American Money, The Life and Philosophy of Ellen Browning Scripps. And of course, when we conceived of this last spring, and this was not yet renovated, we were under construction, but I was like, oh, how could we not have a preeminent Ellen Browning Scripps scholar speak in the newly renovated Ellen Browning Scripps Hall at Bishop School? Molly is a professor at the University of San Diego and also serves as the Interdisciplinary Humanities Department Chair. Okay, I had to do this just to embarrass her because Molly actually does speak quite a bit around town. She's also on the board of the La Jolla Historical Society, and she is a favorite speaker, I would say, of many organizations. So I'm used to kind of seeing her typical bio bit. So I wanted to dig a little deeper for you all tonight and a little bit more to the bishop's end. But I did go on, and my sister's a professor at Emory, and she said, "Oh, we all don't like those sites, but they have like Rape My Professor sites." And I had to look because I knew I would not be surprised, but only delighted. Here's a couple of verbatim quotes from the Rape My Professor site on Molly. "I'm so sad that I'm graduating because I can't take another McClain class. The best prof ever. Dr. McClain is a very nice lady and very, very smart. Our class loves her so much, we visit her office hours for no reason. Take her, she is the best," in all caps. I kid you not, with 3 exclamation points. "She's the best. Her class is all role-playing games that trick you into learning the material." That was my favorite. I asked Molly just a couple of her recollections from Bishop's. When she recalled her favorite teacher, we actually think that we had this math teacher in common, it was Miss Anita Chafee. She later became Mrs. Maurer, wife of Otto Maurer, who was a beloved art history professor at Bishop's for many, many years. And she said, "Miss Chafee, a math teacher, because she had the most beautiful handwriting, she made math equations look like art." That wasn't exactly my memory. I don't know, math went as well for me. I was an English major. Her favorite memory from Bishop's, and when she said this and it came across my computer, I had to smile because I had instant recall. When we attended Bishop's, there were boarders here. So really, equal parts almost boarders and day students. Her favorite memory is just before Christmas break, the boarders were allowed to sing a naughty Christmas carol after formal dinners in Scripps Hall that they were all required to have, to the tune of "Hark the Herald Angels Sing." I'll just give you the first stanza because it's all I'll be allowed to say on a microphone. "Hark the Herald Angels Shout, 6 more days till we get out, 6 more days till we are free from this penitentiary." Oh, those borders, quite a sense of humor. Anyway, without further ado, I present Dr. Molly McClain.
so much. Thanks for having me tonight. I'm very pleased to be here and to talk with you a little bit about Ellen Browning Scripps. Here she is on the cover of Time magazine from 1926. Time magazine then does, as Time magazine continues to do, it profiles kind of famous people, people who are making the news. Back in the 1920s, it was politicians and actresses, industrialists, heavyweight champions. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was on the cover, Jack Dempsey, Ethel Barrymore, Henry Ford. Scripps, on the other hand, she might have been one of the richest women in the country, but she was very far from being a celebrity, much less a household name. And in the article, the Time magazine's editors introduced her to the reader as if they had just discovered a new planet in the solar system, or a unknown element for the periodic table, right? Who is this immensely rich woman, and why does she seem determined to give away millions and millions of dollars? Ellen was born in London, and she grew up actually in poverty on the Illinois prairie. And she went from rags to riches, kind of fulfilling that cherished American story that people can pull themselves up by their bootstraps with audacity, hard work, and a little luck. Now, it helped, that during the age that she was living in, that there were a number of people who did this. Andrew Carnegie, for example, started life in the United States as a textile worker and became one of the richest men in the world. Other industrialists from modest background include Cornelius Vanderbilt, John D. Rockefeller, J.P. Morgan. And these people are often described as robber barons, right? They lived in a country that prized ingenuity and industry, that encouraged the development of new technologies, and tolerated the existence of corruption, exploitation, and greed. Mark Twain humorously described this period as the Gilded Age, when glittering fortunes could be made through graft and speculation and other dubious schemes. Now, Ellen Scripps made an astonishing amount of money without either manipulating the stock market or exploiting the masses. She and her brother Edward Scripps, or E.W. Scripps, created America's largest chain of newspapers, linking Midwestern industrial cities to booming towns in the West. The Scripps papers were cheap to produce, easy to read, and pitched to a working class audience. We find that they're less well known today than, say, the papers that were produced by Joseph Pulitzer or William Randolph Hearst. Those are more familiar names for us. But the Scripps papers transformed their owners into millionaires almost overnight. By the 1920s, Ellen was worth an estimated $30 million, and if you were to translate that into modern dollars, that'd be about $4 billion, most of which she gave away. She established the Scripps Institution of Oceanography in La Jolla. She appeared on the cover actually after having founded Scripps College in Claremont. She obviously provided major financial support to the Bishop School, the La Jolla Recreational Center, Scripps Memorial Hospital, San Diego Zoo, the San Diego Society for Natural History, and founded Torrey Pines State Park. And she also donated millions of dollars worldwide to organizations that promised to advance democratic principles and women's education. So today I'd like to tell you a little bit about her life. Do you think maybe we could get the lights, maybe just in the front part of the room down, just a wee bit? Can you see this? So she was born approximately 175 years ago in 1836. And it was